Well, good morning and welcome to all those who are tuning in to this short act of worship here this morning. And we're getting a little bit more used to this, and hopefully it won't be for too long. But I think it's been an interesting time, just how we communicate with each other through different means. I've been having lots of Zoom meetings during the course of the week, using the Zoom facility. And so we're wondering next Sunday if we can actually see if we can do a live worship service together, and as many of us as possible, even if you haven't actually got around to using Zoom yet, see if you can download that on your computer and see if we can do a live worship session next week. But in the meantime, we're going to try to improve on what we're doing now. And so this morning, I'm just going to share a short word with you. And we're going to give you a link for some songs as well that will accompany this service. So as I say, welcome to you. I hope you're keeping well, and that we're doing our best to keep safe at the same time. So just like to, just really struck by a particular psalm, Psalm 27, which kind of really spoke to me the other day. And I just want to share you this psalm as we open this time of worship together. It's a psalm really of God's protection, of God's provision. And it's a psalm that I think we, God's people, need to hear. The Lord is my light and my salvation, so why should I be afraid? The Lord is my fortress, protecting me from danger, so why should I tremble? When evil people come to devour me, when my enemies and foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though a mighty army surrounds me, my heart will not be afraid. Even if I am attacked, I will remain confident. The one thing I ask of the Lord, the one thing I seek most, is to live in the house of the Lord all my days of my life, delighting in the Lord's perfections and meditating in his temple. For he will conceal me there when troubles come. It's a beautiful psalm, really, of God's assurance of his presence. So even though we can't physically maybe go to his house, as it were, the buildings where we worship at the moment, we can live in the light of his presence, his risen presence among us today. So I've entitled this morning's talk as Peace Be With You. And I want to read a few verses and then a short meditation I'd like to lead us into at the start of this service, around the disciple Andrew. So let's just read this passage together. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. I'd like to read in another version as well, so we can get the even a fuller meaning. This is from the Passion Translation. So the reading is taken from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 22. That evening the disciples gathered together, and because they were afraid of reprisals from the Jewish leaders, they had locked the doors to the place where they had met. But suddenly Jesus appeared among them and said, "Peace to you." Then he showed them the wounds of his hands and his side, and they were overjoyed to see the Lord with their own eyes. Jesus repeated his greeting, "Peace to you." And he told them, "Just as the Father has sent me, I am sending you." Then taking a deep breath, he blew on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." This is from the perspective of the disciple Andrew. "We've seen Jesus." "No, don't laugh. We've seen him, I tell you." He made the mistake of dismissing it ourselves, scoffing when the women came racing back, wild eyes with excitement. "Pull yourself together," we told them. "For God's sake, calm down." We couldn't believe he was alive, refused to accept it. It couldn't possibly be true. And when they admitted they couldn't be certain, they'd only seen the empty tomb rather than Jesus himself, then we looked for some simpler explanation, an answer more in line with common sense. Even when Mary returned tears of joy in her eyes, even when the two from Emmaus spoke of having seen him, we wouldn't accept it. Certain that they would know best. It's understandable, I suppose. I mean, you'd think twice, wouldn't you? If you'd seen your best friend murdered, sealed in a tomb, only to be told that he'd been spotted down the street. And anyway, we didn't want to build our hopes up. We were still reeling from the shock, the horror, the sorrow of it all. Yet, if I'm honest, there was more to it than that. For most of all, our pride was hurt. If he was alive, we reasoned then, why hadn't we seen him? Why should Mary or those two disciples or anyone else come to that have seen him before we did? We were his chosen disciples. We were the ones who'd given up everything to follow him. We, those who had taken all the risks. So if he had risen, surely we'd have known. It's awful, I know, but that's the way we saw it until he finally appeared to us. We should have remembered, of course, what he said so often. How the first will be last, the least greatest. And we still have much to learn. And we're still full of ourselves by half. Anyway, there we were, huddled together in that upstairs room, arguing about what it all meant. When there he was, standing among us, arms outstretched in welcome. Where he came from, or where he went after that, I had no idea. I only know that we were with him, Jesus, and that he was alive, wonderful, amazing, glorious. He was alive. So I've entitled this talk this morning, Peace Be With You. It's that phrase we share when we take communion, don't we? So let's do that one acclamation of praise, remembering that Christ, we now worship the risen Christ Jesus. So Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. So last Sunday, as we celebrated, albeit virtually, that Christ Jesus had risen from the dead, his resurrection is all about that life for us. It's living a life that triumphs over death, living a life full of opportunities and possibilities, a life full of purpose made possible by Jesus rising from that tomb. We join with Jesus, his own disciples, who after Jesus' death were living in the grips of fear and shame together. And as we navigate through this time of uncertainty, it is natural to feel fearful and concerned about how we as a country move forward from here. Will there be employment for me? The pandemic has flagged up so many new challenges as to how we live in community, how the church will function. For the Christian community, we need to fix our eyes on God and see what God is doing and plan how the church should respond to it. Last week, in Matthew's account of the resurrection, the women at the tomb encounter an angel whose words echoed throughout the Bible some 365 times, a reassurance of each day of the week, with the words, do not be afraid. So in our reading today, we meet again Jesus' chosen disciples in a room together, which was firmly locked for fear of the Jews. Now just 11 of them, as Judas Iscariot had killed himself. The last time they had seen Jesus was at his arrest in Gethsemane, when they had all deserted him except for Peter, who then went on to deny him. Yet when Mary told the disciples that she'd seen the risen Lord, Peter and John rushed to the tomb, which would have been the perfect place for the guards really to arrest them. So how could they really be afraid of the Jews in this upper room, this locked room? Or was it that if Jesus was raised from the dead and they met him, what would he say to them? They had every reason to be afraid, as I'm sure they would have felt so ashamed of themselves, having deserted Jesus at his time of need. I'm sure rather than to go and search for Jesus, it would have been safer just to stay put and hope that this current wave of emotions would just simply go away. I was really challenged when I read this bit because it made me think of the times when I've tried to just really keep the doors locked, or maybe my heart locked up in the hope that Jesus wouldn't take a look. Or maybe to cover up fear of the future, as many of us will be experiencing right now. But then an amazing things happen. Jesus enters the very room where they were gathered together, full of fear and shame and anxiety, and says those incredible words, "Peace be with you." Just to combat and overcome all the negative feelings and emotions of the disciples. And as he gazes into their eyes, they shine on all the things that he knows. Their failures, the way they deserted him, their weaknesses, their disappointments, all the things that have gone wrong. He doesn't say, "I forgive you." He doesn't need to. They know he has. They are able to now move into the first day of the rest of their lives. A new start as restored disciples, equipped for the next leg of the journey with him. And as we keep on connecting with each other, as we learn new things, as we see what God is doing, as we experience a new awakening and strengthening of St. John's, as God shows us afresh why we exist, as we keep praying, as we keep interceding, as we rely totally on Jesus, we, like the disciples, then will receive a new empowering to reach out to the community around us and share the love of Jesus with all those we meet. Like the disciples received together in that locked room, let Jesus breathe on you and receive the empowerment of the Holy Spirit afresh. I was reminded in Genesis 2:7, when God first breathed life into man and he began to live. Jesus' resurrection gives us life in abundance. Even though you may want to hide from Jesus out of shame from the past, the risen Jesus, because of his amazing love for us, will track us down, find us, and say those amazing words, "Peace be with you." He will then go on to restore you and equip you and help us lead life to the full, an adventure and a purpose with him. Let's just pray together. Loving God, despite our faith, we have to confess there are times when we find life really difficult, when situations seem hopeless, when we look to the future fearfully, wondering what good it can possibly hold. Help us to understand that the truth of resurrection is not just limited to the future, to life after death, but is about the present, life now. Help us to realise it speaks not just about eternal issues, but about our daily lives. The ordinary, the commonplace, the mundane. Help us to understand that even there, and especially there, you bring resurrection. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm really pleased to announce at the end of this short video that Sarah is just going to share us a little bit of testimony before we reflect more on what's been said through the songs. So bless you and keep safe and well, and I hope we can soon meet up soon. God bless.
Good morning, St. John's. I do hope you're all well. I've been asked to share a little bit of a realisation that I've had over the last coming weeks. With all what's been going on in the world, people, you know, being scared, full of anxiety, the loneliness, the fear, I've come to realise how much my faith has grown. You know, I was once one of those people full of fear. I would have been straight on the bandwagon and off and running. I have been working from home, and I have been lucky enough to keep myself safe in that way, and it will continue. You know, but in this time that I've been able to be a bit more still, I've been spending a little bit more time with God. And when I say spending time with him, I don't necessarily mean praying. I mean just being in his presence, feeling his presence, soaking up his spirit. And while I've been doing this, you know, I come to realise I've not been feeling any of those negative feelings, you know, the fear, the anxiety, the loneliness. It's gone. It's gone. And all I've been feeling is, you know, a sense of contentment. It's all going to be okay. Love. A love that I've not felt before. You know, and it's just proven to me my faith has grown so much. My trust in God has grown so much. I suppose what I'm trying to say is we were talking about a passage in the Bible in the week, you know, and it says, there's no fear in perfect love. Love drives out fear. And I just think this is, you know, a great example. My love for God and God's love within me has cast out all my fears. I just really wanted to share that with you. I just feel like it's a massive step in my faith for me. Exciting. There was also something else that popped to my mind, you know, when I was thinking about what I actually wanted to say today. And I just want to leave it with yous, really. With everything that's going on in the world, I just think it's, you know, irrelevant. So it's something I heard very early on in my faith. You know, someone said it to me and I carried it with me for a while. Used to pray on it, but you know, for some reason it you know, I forgot about it, but it sprung to mind this week, so I just want to leave it with you. It's 2 Timothy 1:7, and it's, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but power and of love and a sound mind. I just think that's great for anyone that's really struggling right now. Just bear that in mind. Stay safe. I love you all. God bless.
worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
It is.